Well, that's Helen there. I'm joined now by the Brexit-supporting economist, Gerard Lyons, and by Remainer, Mariana Mazzucato, whose book, Rethinking Capitalism, addresses many of the financial issues that will confront the new Prime Minister. But first, Rupert Harrison, who did work as George Osborne's chief of staff. I mean, how much of Osborneomics do you think survives the transition, Rupert?
I think, apart from dealing with Brexit and the relationship with the EU, which I think is going to overwhelm economic policymaking for the next few years, other than that, I think, you know, Theresa May, as you'd expect, a new Prime Minister, there's going to be some changes of emphasis and tone. But largely, I think it's going to be continuity. It's going to be struggling, I think, still with public finances that are not going to be ideal. And then if you think about the big, you know, some of the big themes of economic policy of the last 6 years, it's included cutting taxes on the low paid, the national living wage, binding votes, shareholder votes on executive pay, cracking down on tax avoidance, tax evasion. So I think it's going to be more continuity. Outside of Brexit, which is the elephant in the room.
Have you spoken to George?
I haven't.
No. Do you think he'll look back on his time at number 11 with satisfaction? I mean, it obviously hasn't ended as he would want it to.
I think perhaps apart from the end, obviously he wanted a different result in the referendum. Overall, I think so. I mean, I think that the judgment must be he inherited an economy at probably one of the darkest moments in our economic history. I always remember Mervyn King, before 2010, said whoever inherited the situation at the upcoming election would have to take such difficult decisions they'd be out of power for a generation. And I think that did sum up the scale of the challenge, a massive deficit, a fragile banking system, a sovereign debt crisis on our doorstep. And then we had unemployment fall to 5%, the highest employment rate in our history. GDP growth has been the same as the US over the last 6 years. So I think he could be pretty satisfied with that part of it.
Mariana, how big a change, if you take Theresa May at her word of what she said in speeches and on the steps of Downing Street, how big a change is that?
Well, if you take her three big points, which are about productivity, lagging wages, and the need to reform executive pay, and the need for, she actually said the word, industrial policy, a word that I think Sajid Javid has not said. Vince Cable did, David Willetts did, you know, Peter Mandelson did, Chukwuemeka did. The current minister of BIS has not said that word. He actually is sort of running the ministry as a enterprise zone, I think, which is, you know, just about reducing different types of impediments for business. Somehow it's all about tax and regulations. If she goes ahead with those three things, really tackling productivity, tackling the issues around executive pay, and actually reigniting a vision around industrial policy and innovation policy, that will require a massive change. It will require change both in the Treasury, but especially she'll need absolutely a new minister in BIS. because currently, you know, they're not, if you want, running a show which is trying to get long-term investment in this country, reforming finance. I mean, Hammond, I found very interesting in a recent speech, actually continued to say that financial services is one of our key industries that depends on what you want finance to do. Finance currently in this country is actually not serving the real economy. Right. Nothing has been done on that. So if she wants to, again, you know, have proper innovation policy, we will need the proper kind of finance.
Gerard Lyons, do you think what we heard today or what we've heard over the last week from her, big shift? Or just maybe it's just words?
I think there will be a significant shift. There is some continuity, obviously, in the fact that the Conservatives were elected on the manifesto last year, so they still have to implement that manifesto.
What do you mean they have to? They've junked this fiscal stuff.
Well,
she's
actually,
talking of an industrial policy.
I think there is
in the manifesto.
On fiscal stuff, they do need
executive pay. It's completely different.
Yeah, well, there will be some continuity, but I was just going on to say there needs to be a significant shift. Fiscal policy, I felt the previous Chancellor became far too tactical in many of his budgets. We do need to see a strategic shift. We need to see more investment, more innovation, and more infrastructure spending. The UK government can now borrow at the lowest rate ever. Obviously, it's been lower now than it was in recent years, so that creates a great opportunity. Monetary policy has in the past and is still now a big shock absorber for the economy. So that obviously is still there. But fiscal policy, I think, needs to move on. And of course, we have Brexit strategy. And there's really three pots that we need to look at.
Hold the Brexit one for a minute, because I want to get to that. But just the other
thing.
It will be key.
But the real issue here is we now have a fantastic opportunity post the referendum to reposition the UK in the changing, growing global economy. Despite the near-term uncertainty, there are lots of positives, and it's about really positioning ourselves with the India, China, US, Indo-Pacific region. We've decided few weeks the Eurozone was the slow growth region.
But first, you're saying so much, I want to put one of your points. Basically, Rupert, it sounds like the gist of these two guys is this is a complete turnaround because there was too much austerity. He underinvested. There was no need to. Borrowing was cheap. This is all really just ripping up George Osborne's
Well, I think Theresa May would be thrilled to hear this because her speech obviously had the impact she wanted. Look, of course, there's going to be a change of tone. I think, as I say, I think the elephant in the room is Brexit, renegotiating our trade relations with the rest of the room. That is massive. Outside of that, I think it's going to be mainly continuity. I mean, putting curbs on executive pay, I mean, in the last 6 years, there have been binding shareholder votes on executive pay that there never were. The other things she talked about, tax avoidance, tax evasion, government, and of course, she's a new prime minister. She wants to put a new tone, new emphasis. But as I say, outside of the core issues, I mean, industrial strategy, I mean, it's true that Sajid Javid doesn't use the phrase, but for the last 6 years, there's been enormous investment in industrial strategy in the UK.
But just to be clear, I'm saying that if she was to do what she said, that would require a revolution. Personally, I don't think it'll be possible. Brexit, as David Cameron has said, will occupy the civil service for the next, decade. It's a
massive,
complete waste of time.
Everything.
The investment that you're talking about in research and development, the investment also in human capital formation, by the way, which is also a result of all sorts of public, also transnational investments, are not going to happen now with Brexit. 80 billion euros of research money is what we no longer have access to, research
actually,
and development.
Quite on the contrary. In fact, we often overlook the fact that we did give Brussels as much of the money in the first place. The life science sector, when I was working in London the last few years for the mayor, the life science sector with MedCity combining Oxford, Cambridge, London, that is now seeing itself in a great opportunity for the future.
Let's not have the Brexit argument.
No, it is very important. But what Rupert was saying earlier was very important. It was about creating the enabling environment in the past. And it's still about creating the enabling environment now. It's not about putting all the levers at the centre.
But don't you think there's been a shift in emphasis towards a more continental model, more regulation? It's the exact opposite of what you Brexiteers, a lot of you, selling to us, which was a kind of deregulated hub.
Well, that's maybe how you would like it to be. But
no,
I think
that's telling us it was going to be.
No, I think there is obviously the benefit of trying to pick best practice from around the world. But at the end of the day, we need to do what suits the UK economy. And in terms of the UK economy, it does come back to the Brexit issue. The Brexit issue is very much about three pots. Two pots need to be ticked. One is the sovereignty pot. The second pot is basically having an immigration policy, probably a points-based immigration system. And we do not need to be in the single market. We need, as Peter Lilly was saying earlier, it's about basically positioning the UK outside the single market, not just with an eye on the continent, with an eye on the global economy. And if we do that, we will still be a very attractive place in which to invest. But the key change, coming back to Evan's earlier point, infrastructure spending is maybe the big change I would expect to see. And also tax cuts, maybe Phil Hammond. Well,
Mariana.
We continue to have lagging investment in this country. We have very low business spending in areas like research and development.
What we know is
that what actually guides investment, sort of the long-term investment that we need, not the kind of short-term
The biggest barrier to infrastructure investment in the UK at the moment is not money. It is capacity.
But it's not just about infrastructure.
Like rail,
why do we
road,
just talk
so
about
much
infrastructure?
I tell you what, we're going to come back to this.
It's about a redirection for the economy. What kind of infrastructure? Green infrastructure.
That's what
Germany does.
We have to come back to this. I'm so sorry.
We've lost our negotiating power.
We're going to have to. But there's so much. We're going to have to disentangle this and put it into 10 discussions over the next 5 years.